The word of the Lord to us today is, take heed that you do not fall short. We can fall short of the glory of God and fail to finish the race. Or we can finish the race and still be in God's grace, but fail to receive a full reward. Fail to receive all that God wants to give us, what He has planned for our lives. And one way we do have salvation, but we would have never pleased the Lord to the fullness. Therefore, we would have never received the fullness of the reward that He had planned for us. Or we can fall short of the grace of God altogether and fall away from God and end up being cursed and cast as profane into the lake of fire. So the word of the Lord today to us is, take heed that you do not fall away. When I think of people falling away, of course, I always think of Solomon. Because Solomon had such splendor. He had everything. God had blessed him to be the king of all of Israel. He had anointed him. He had given him his Holy Spirit. He allowed him to build the house of God. And yet God told him, take heed, Solomon. Stay away from foreign women. Stay away from women who worship other gods or who do not worship the true God, who do not worship me, because they will surely turn you away from me. And of course, that's what happened. And in his old age, not only did he turn away from God, but he turned to, from serving God fully, he turned to worshiping pagan gods, among which were the gods of the Ammonites and the Midianites, which was Chemosh and Moloch. Detestable idols where the children of Israel actually sacrificed their children to. Moloch was a metal image, a metal idol, which was hollow inside, and they would build the fire inside till it was hot, red hot, and his hands were outstretched like this at a bull's head in order to receive the sacrifice of babies. And the Israelite young women would sacrifice their children and lay their children. And the priest of Moloch would be drumming loudly so that you couldn't hear the screams and the wailing and lamenting. You know, sin just spreads. It just spreads. You know, those two peoples, those two tribes of people were birthed from incest, from Lot's daughters. And they got Lot drunk after, you know, Sodom was destroyed. And God brought Lot out, and his wife turned to look back at the wicked city, and God turned her into a pillar of salt. And there was no one for his two daughters, so they conspired to have children by their father, but they knew that the father would not consent to such a sin. So they got him drunk until he passed out, and then they lay with him, and their two children became the scourge of Israel. And even Solomon in his old age built high places for them, temples for them, setting just across the Temple Mount of the house he built for the Lord. From the temple of God, you could look across and see children sacrificing, see people, Israelites, sacrificing their children to Moloch and to Chemosh. That's how it spreads, a little at a time. One tiny step at a time. One small compromise at a time, until you find yourself very far away from the truth, very far away from God. Take heed that you do not fall away. Take heed that you're careful to seek God and to please Him and to seek Him with a whole heart. One of my heroes is Jehu, who was a citizen of the northern kingdom after the split. After, you know, because of what Solomon did, God tore the kingdom from him. Even had the house of God destroyed by the Babylonians. But he tore the kingdom from him. But he waited till after he died. And when his son Rehoboam became king, he tore the kingdom from him, leaving him just two tribes. The 10 tribes, the northern tribes, became their own nation. And they appointed wicked Jeroboam as their king, who erected two idols, two golden calves, one in Penuel and one in Bethel. Bethel is a house of God. Bethel is where Jacob saw the stairway to heaven. He dreamed of the stairway to heaven. He called it a sacred place, so they put a golden calf there to worship. And he said, we're going to have a feast. On the 15th day of the 8th month, that was 30 days later than the Feast of Tabernacles. Actually, he didn't say the 15th day. He said, we'll have one 30 days like the Feast of Tabernacles. And if you check carefully in history, you'll see that his priests became known as the Druids later on in the British Isles. And you'll find that those priests brought with them that festival, which is called Halloween today, which is a gross perversion of the last great day, the second resurrection. And that's why at Halloween they believe the dead are walking. The dead have come up and they're walking. You see, it's a gross perversion. And that's how sin is, little by little. Later on, after the death of Ahab, wicked Ahab, Jezebel is still alive. Her wicked son is ruling, but she's really pulling the strings behind the scenes. God raises up a mighty man, one of my heroes, Jehu. Everything was against him. Living in this wicked kingdom where idolatry was everywhere. But Elisha, God saw something in him, and God told Elisha, send one of the sons of the prophet and you go anoint him. Because I am proclaiming him to be king of Israel. That is, king of the northern 10 tribes. And so he went and he anointed him. And when his companions saw that, they proclaimed him, you are surely king. We receive that. And God said, now here's what I want you to do. I want you to go destroy the house of Ahab. Don't leave one. You kill every one of them. It's a judgment from me. And he went, and he rode like the wind. You could just feel it when you read those scriptures in Kings and in Chronicles, 2 Chronicles. And he found the king of Judah, at this time was wicked, and the king of Israel together. Because the king of Israel had been wounded. The king of Judah had come to visit him. He found them together, but he wasn't so wounded that he couldn't get around. He was just home recuperating. They went out to meet Jehu when he was coming. And they said, are you coming in peace? He said, there's no peace. There's no peace as long as wickedness reigns. There will be no peace as long as the wicked are in power. And they took off, and Jehu drew his bow, and he shot the king of Israel right through the heart, killed him. And then they chased down the wicked king of Judah and killed him too. Now everybody's worried. Jezebel is back home and she's worried. She's back in Samaria and she's worried what's going to happen. And she hears that Jehu is coming. And the people are excited and there's talk that he may be king. She hears that her son has been killed by Jehu. So she paints her eyes and she makes herself attractive. And she looks out the window and Jehu looks up and he says, throw her down. And they threw her down. And blood splattered even on the horses and on the wall. Later on, Jehu said, you know what? We need to bury her. After all, she was a queen, even though she was wicked. But They went to get her, and there wasn't anything left of her because the dogs had eaten her. Well, they found the palms of her hand. That was about it. And so Jehu made great reforms. I mean, fantastic reforms. He tore down all the temples of the pagan idols. And he commanded people to worship the Lord, the true God. But you know, he fell a little short. He was still considered righteous by God. He's not lost, but he didn't receive a full reward. You know why? He stumbled over the golden calf in Penuel and the golden calf in Bethel. And he didn't deal with them, and he didn't stop the worship there. You see. So we have the story of two kings, one of Judah, well, one of all Israel, and one of the northern tribes after the split. Both of them began righteous. One of them turned away in his old age. The other one lost part of his reward, but he was still considered righteous because, for the most part, for a citizen of Samaria, he was very righteous. But because he didn't deal with those golden calves, God sent war. God caused problems upon the land. And brethren, there's always going to be problems if you compromise with the world. If you give in, there's going to be problems. You can be saved, but you'll have trouble. Amen? God wants us to have the fullness of the reward that he has for us. Amen? And we should really catch that. If you don't seek the Lord with your whole heart, you just won't receive it. It just won't be there. Amen? Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, beginning in verse 7. It is for discipline that you endure. God deals with you as with sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? But if you're without discipline, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate children and not sons. So God is saying through the writer of Hebrews that he disciplines all of his children. Now, discipline just simply means to correct. Listen, discipline means to set right. Now, God only disciplines those who have not disciplined themselves. Amen. We are told to discipline ourselves. We're told to look at the Word of God, look at God's instruction, and then make the corrections, make the changes necessary. Conform our life to what the Word of God says. That's allowing God to correct us. But if we don't allow God to correct us through His Word, God will correct us through circumstances. Amen? And then if He finds that we're not correctable, then we fall short of the glory of God, and there's nothing left but a fiery judgment. Amen? Verse 9, therefore, furthermore, we had earthly fathers to discipline us, and we respected them. Shall we not much rather be subject to the Father of spirits and live? For they disciplined us for a short time, as seemed best to them. But he, that is God, he disciplines us for our good, so that we may share his holiness. Now I admit I'm a father of five, two sons, three daughters. And I tried to discipline for their good, but sometimes I have to admit I discipline for my good. I discipline for my sanity. Sometimes, you know, I discipline one of my children because they were driving me crazy. I know what some of you are thinking. They succeeded, right? All right. But he disciplines us for our good. Notice, so that why? So that we may share his holiness. Amen? Why? To share his holiness. All discipline for the moment seems not to be joyful, but sorrowful. Yet to those who have been trained by it, afterwards it yields the peaceful fruit of righteousness. So that is the goal of discipline. Now notice verse 12. Therefore, strengthen the hands that are weak. Now that's talking about. Prop up, strengthen, discipline the hands that are weak. Because he's saying, look, discipline doesn't seem good at first, but it is good. And it will produce righteousness and the holiness of God in us. Therefore, strengthen the hands that are weak and the knees that are feeble. And make paths for your feet. That means you don't leave people weak and you don't leave people feeble. You strengthen. Now, how do you strengthen? You encourage to good works. You encourage people to fight. Fight the good fight. Conform your life to the Word of God. Yield to God. Submit to God. And then you will find that the devil will flee from you. Therefore, strengthen the hands that are weak and the knees that are feeble, and make straight paths for your feet, so that the limb which is lame may not be put out of joint, but rather be healed. So he's saying, look, if a joint is out, you know, you want to make it straight so it'll be healed. You don't want to leave it out. It may eventually stop hurting, but it won't be healed. You'll walk like Chester on the old Gunsmoke series, see? Now, strengthen the hands that are weak and the knees that are feeble. Make straight paths for your feet. Brethren, let me tell you. When you look at Israel and Judah, after the split, I mean, you look at the people of God, and basically, their lives become reflective of the environment they're in. And the environment, basically, is a reflection of the leadership of the king. And if the king makes reforms, ever so often you had a righteous king that came in and made reforms. They tore down the altars of the idols, you see, and established the commandments of God. And the people of God prospered every time. And every time there was compromise, every time when they straddled the fence, you know, and God says, how long are you going to straddle the fence? You remember what Elijah said? How long, Israel? How long are you going to serve God? And you're going to serve Baal. I mean, you leave the altar of God to go serve at the altar of Baal. How long? He said, if Baal is God, serve him. If the Lord God is God, serve him. But you can't do both. But that's what almost everybody does. That's what almost everybody does. Well, I'll come into the kingdom of God, yet I'll still stay in the kingdom of the world. And go along to get along. No, you can't go along to get along. Because you will fall short. You'll fall short. Amen. We have to stand strong. We have to be a light. How are we being a light? People are supposed to look at our lives and say, okay. You know, people have the idea, well, it's my life. I'll do what I want to with it. Go ahead. Go ahead and do what you want to with it. Because as long as you're doing what you want to with it, God can't do what he wants to with it. Amen? Would you rather be all you can be all that God can make you? I think God can do a whole lot more with me than I can with me. Amen? We do not belong to ourselves. We don't have the right to do whatever we want to do. God purchased us with the blood of Jesus. Verse 14, pursue peace with all men and the sanctification with which no one will see the Lord. You remember what Jesus said. Look, if you're giving an offering, if you're presenting something to the Lord, doesn't matter what you're presenting. You may be presenting praise. You may be presenting a monetary offering. You may be presenting an offering of service of some type. If you have anything against your brother, Jesus said, leave it there. Leave it there and go fix that. Now, you can't fix it on your own. All you can do is your part. You can't do the other person's part. All you can do is your part. Pursue peace with all men as much as it is possible. Some people will not be at peace with you, and that's all right. We understand that. But we have to be at peace with all men as much as possible for us. And when it says the sanctification of which no one will see the Lord, that's what he's saying. Look, leave it. Don't you come through the veil. As long as there's something between you and somebody else. So he's saying, pursue peace with all men and the sanctification with which no one will see the Lord. See to it that no one comes short, of the grace of God, that no root of bitterness springing up causes trouble, and by it many be defiled. That there is no immoral person or godless person like Esau, who sold his own birthright for a single meal. For you know that even afterwards, when he desired to inherit the blessing, he was rejected. For he found no place for repentance, though he sought it with tears. There is a sorrow. There is a sorrow. The conscience can come up and just make the heart sad. And when that happens, you can kind of see how far you've fallen. You can see where you are, and you can see, well, I know this is not what I should be in the Lord. And you momentarily try to seek to change, but you can't change. You're like Esau. You can't change. And you can't change because you don't have a heart for God. Only people that have a heart to seek the Lord can change. Because the Lord said, my people always go astray in their heart. It's a heart matter. If you don't have a heart to please God, to obey God, you won't. You just won't do it. Your conscience can bother you. And because it bothers you, it can cause you to do some things momentarily, but you'll have no lasting power as long as it's not in your heart. Now, you know, we find ourselves like that. We can pray to God like David did. Create in me a clean heart. Renew a right spirit in me. But that's what it takes. Amen. Because the heart will only put up with so much from the conscience. And then after a while, the heart will cut the conscience off. It will sear it. Where the conscience can no longer even affect the heart at all. And when that happens, what God does is he gives people over to a spirit of delusion that they would believe the lie. If somebody wants to believe the lie, they will. That's fact. You want to believe the lie, you will. Be careful what you believe, brother. Be careful what you give yourself to believe. But let me tell you something. You believe any lie. Any lie. Any lie. Any. You opened yourself up. I'm saying any. You believe any lie. Then you've brought falsehood. You've brought deception into your heart. Now look. That's a dangerous place to be. You will not be there. You won't be there. You won't be there that day When you knock on the door, he'll say, I never knew you. Now, that's a fact. Don't think it's not. It is a fact. God doesn't change. God is the same. He's the same God. The same God that dealt with Solomon, that dealt with David, is the same God. The same God that rained fire down on Sodom and Gomorrah and Tyre and Sidon is the same God. And the Bible says in the New Testament, he did that to show what's going to happen to the ungodly if they don't repent. You know what Jesus said? Jesus said, he heard people talking. Wow. Did you hear about that? Did you hear about all those people? 17 people died. This tower over in Siloam, it just fell. And 17 people died. It fell on them. Wow. Somebody said, yeah. They thought they'd get away from God. But you know, his guys go to and fro. He knows where the wicked are. Yeah. Yeah. They were great sinners. I don't know what they did. But I know they were great sinners. And they, God, put that judgment on them. And Jesus heard to talk about it. And he said, do you suppose that those men whom the tower fell on were greater sinners than everybody else? Now, there's no record of anybody saying, yep. Or, I don't know. I mean, I imagine everybody just saying, I don't want to be a fool. I'm going to just wait till he answers his own question. And he said, I tell you, no. No, they weren't worse sinners because they died. I tell you, unless you all likewise repent, you will all perish. That's what he said. Without repentance, and that means turn away from practicing sin, everybody will perish. Because God's kingdom is a righteous kingdom. And the righteous are going to rule in that kingdom and live in that kingdom. So verse 14 again. Pursue peace with all men and the sanctification without which no one will see the Lord. See to it that no one comes short of the grace of God. And no root of bitterness springing up causes trouble, and by it many be defiled. That there be no immoral or godless person like Esau, who sold his own birthright for a single meal. You know, that birthright was a type of our birthright in Christ Jesus. He being the firstborn of many brethren. For you know that even afterwards, when he desired to inherit the blessing, he was rejected. For he found no place for repentance. Why was he rejected? Because he could not repent. Why couldn't he repent? Because he had a wicked heart that did not love the things of God, did not love the truth of God. You know, God said in Romans chapter 9, Jacob I love, Esau I hated. He said that before they were born. Because he saw, he declared the end from the beginning. He saw, he looked ahead and he saw Esau's life. He saw that Esau did not even value the blessing of the Lord. The firstborn, the birthright blessing. So I don't care. Give me a bowl of soup for it. You can have it. What would you sell your birthright for, brethren? What would you sell it for? Would you sell it for a woman? Would you sell it for money? Would you sell it for unforgiveness? Would you sell it for a job? What would you sell it for? For the world, the things of the world? What would you sell your birthright for? Esau sold it for a bowl of soup. And you know, everything in this world is nothing more than a bowl of soup. That's it. I mean, if you are willing to give up a birthright, God says, you're my child. You walk with me. You follow me. I give you my instruction, my commands, so that you will be like me. Walk as I do. It's easy to come up short. You know, brethren, the whole world, the whole Christian world comes up short. They don't enter into the seventh day. They don't enter into the rest. That is set apart. That is set apart for the work of God, for service, for worship. I don't know if you know this or not, but you know the story of Cain and Abel. In the King James, it says that when they came to give their offerings, it says at the end of days. And my New American Standard says in the course of time. But if you look it up, it means on the Sabbath. Isn't that funny? At the end of the week, when the Sabbath began. And almost every scholar will tell you that. Adam Clark, Jameson Fawcett Brown, to name a couple. After 6 days of labor, then they brought their offering, the fruit of their labor, to the Lord on the Sabbath day. And Abel's offering was accepted, but Cain's offering was not accepted. You know why? Because 1 John chapter 3 says that his deeds were evil. God does not want an offering from someone that is not obeying him. You remember when Saul sacrificed to the Lord and Samuel came and said, "What do you do this for? You're not supposed to sacrifice. I am." And Saul said, "Well, you weren't here. And I had to do something. The Philistines were coming upon us. My army was going home. I had to do something. I had to sacrifice. We were going to go into battle." And Samuel asked the question, "Does the Lord care more about sacrifice or obedience?" And Saul was rejected. You know, because his sacrifice was not united with obedience. Amen. You know why Jesus' sacrifice was received? Because he obeyed the Lord in all things. He said, "I've kept my Father's commandments and I obey him in all things." 1 Corinthians chapter 9. We'll begin at verse 22. Paul says, "To the weak I became weak, that I may win the weak." So he had a purpose for that. "I have become all things to all men, so that I may by all means save some." That was his objective. That's my objective. My objective is to save some, and my objective is to keep those who are saved, saved. Amen? He's the same way. He wants to save some, and he wants to keep those saved, saved. He wants to keep them in the grace of God. "I have become all things to all men, so that I may by all means save some. I do all things for the sake of the gospel, so that I may become a fellow partaker of it. Do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but only one receives the prize? So he said, run in such a way that you may win. Everyone who competes in the games exercises self-control in all things. They then do it to receive a perishable wreath, but we for an imperishable one. Therefore, I run in such a way as not without aim. I box in such a way as not beating the air, but I discipline my body and make it my slave." Now notice, "so that after I've preached to others, I myself will not be disqualified." So see, Paul knew that he could be disqualified. Amen. He said, "You know why I do all this? Because I take the gospel serious. I know that I can fall short." Verse 1 of chapter 10. "For I do not want you to be unaware, brethren." Now this is a continuation. He said, look, I could be disqualified myself, and I don't want you to be unaware that our fathers were all under the cloud. He's talking about the Israelites. "And they all passed through the sea, and they were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. And all ate the same spiritual food, and all drank the same spiritual drink. For they were drinking from a spiritual rock which followed them, and the rock was Christ. Nevertheless, with most of them, God was not well pleased. For they were laid low in the wilderness," and that was a wilderness of sin. The Sinai wilderness, the wilderness of sin. And right now we find ourselves in Christ, in salvation, in life, in righteousness, blameless in Him, but living in the wilderness of sin in this world. Amen. Now these things happened as examples for us, so that we would not crave evil things as they also craved. Do not be idolaters, as some of them were. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and stood up to play. Nor let us act immorally, as some of them did. And 23,000 fell in one day. Nor let us try or tempt the Lord, as some of them did, and they were destroyed by the serpents. Nor let us grumble, as some of them did, and were destroyed by the destroyer. Now these things happened to them as an example, and they were written for our instruction, upon whom the ends of the ages have come. Therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed that he does not fall. No temptation has overtaken you, but such as is common to man. And God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will provide the way of escape also, so that you will be able to endure it. Now, turn with me to 2 Chronicles chapter 12. Let's look at Solomon's life. 2 Chronicles chapter 7. Now, Solomon, of course, had the temple of God built, and it was glorious. I mean, there was no expense spared in building this temple, one of the wonders of the world. Probably the most magnificent building ever made. Now, notice verse 1 of chapter 7. Now, in chapter 6, Solomon gives the prayer of dedication, a beautiful prayer to dedicate the temple of God. Listen, dedicating the temple of God to the living God. This is for your service. This is your house. Now notice, now when Solomon had finished praying, fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering. So there was the altar. There was no fire on the altar. The fire of the Lord came down and took the offering and the sacrifices. Notice, and the glory of the Lord filled the house. That's a Shekinah cloud, the presence of God. The priests could not even enter into the house of the Lord because of the glory, and it filled the Lord's house. Now down to verse 11, notice. Thus Solomon finished the house of the Lord in the king's palace and successfully completed all that he had planned on doing in the house of the Lord and in his palace. Then the Lord appeared to Solomon at night, and he said to them, I have heard your prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice. Notice, if I shut up the heavens that there is no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence upon my people, and my people who are called by name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. Now that's a promise from God. I mean, obviously God is not going to allow any of these things to happen like that unless we're displeasing Him. That would be His discipline. But if we humble ourselves before the Lord and humble it, I mean, we can fast before God and humble ourselves to say, okay, you're in charge. You're the head. And I'm not. Then He is faithful to hear, and He will forgive us of our sins, and He will heal the land. Now notice verse 15. Now my eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayer offered in this place. For now I have chosen and consecrated this house that my name may be there forever. And my eyes and my heart will be there perpetually. As for you, If you walk before me as your father David walked, even to do according to all that I have commanded you, and will keep my statutes and my ordinances, then I will establish your royal throne as I covenanted with your father, as I made a covenant with your father David, saying, you shall not lack a man to be ruler in Israel. So it's based upon if. Now, you know, God is going to keep David's throne alive. He said that already to David. So he's promising to do that. But he's saying, Solomon, if you want it to be well with you, it depends on you. Depends on how committed you are. Now notice, but, verse 19, but if you turn away and forsake my statutes and my commandments, which I have set before you, and go and serve other gods and worship them, then I will uproot you from the land which I have given you, and this house which I have consecrated for my name, I will cast out of my sight. And I will make it a proverb and a byword among all peoples. As for this house which was exalted, everyone who passes by will be astonished and say, why has the Lord done this to the land and to his house? And they will say, because they forsook the Lord, the God of their fathers, who brought them from the land of Egypt, and they adopted other gods and worshiped them and served them. Therefore, he has brought all this adversity on them. Now turn with me back to 1 Kings. First Kings chapter 11. Verse 1. Now King Solomon loved many foreign women, along with the daughter of Pharaoh, Moabite, Ammonite, Edomite, Sidonian, and Hittite women, from the nations concerning which the Lord had said to the sons of Israel, you shall not associate with them, nor shall they associate with you, for they will surely turn your heart away after their gods. Solomon held fast to these in love. They just got to the point where he loved his wives more than he loved God. He had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines. And his wives turned his heart away. Sad story. For when Solomon was the wisest man on the earth. Apart from Jesus, he was the wisest man that has ever lived. His glory was so magnificent that people came from all over the known world to talk to Solomon, to hear his wisdom. Yet as wise as he was, you know, a lot of people think they can handle things. Well, I can handle it. No, you can't. If Solomon can't handle it, you can't. If the Lord says don't, you can't handle it. You can't handle it. And if you dabble in it, you don't want to handle it in the first place. Amen. For Solomon was old. For when Solomon was old, his wives turned his heart away after other gods. And his heart was not wholly devoted to the Lord his God, as the heart of David his father had been. Verse 5. For Solomon went after Ashtoreth. And of course, that's the sex goddess, fertility goddess. The goddess of the Sidonians, and after Milcom, the detestable idol of the Ammonites. And Solomon did what was evil in the sight of the Lord, and did not follow the Lord fully as David his father had done. Then Solomon built a high place for Chemosh, the detestable idol of Moab, on the mountain which is east of Jerusalem. And for Moloch, the detestable idol of the sons of Ammon. These he also did for all his foreign wives who burned incense and sacrifice to their gods. Verse 9. Now the Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart was turned away from the Lord. I mean, you just think about it. God had such plans for Solomon. He had wonderful plans for him. But Solomon turned away. Solomon chose the things of this world. He chose to have a divided heart. Well, did he continue to sacrifice to God? Of course he did. But did God honor it? No, he didn't. I don't even know. I wonder sometimes what was in his mind when he died. If he thought he stood. If he knew that the Holy Spirit had left him. I don't know. If God had given him over to a deluding spirit that would cause him to believe a lie. I don't know. But it is a sad story. Now the Lord was angry, verse 9, with Solomon, because his heart was turned away from the Lord. And the God of Israel, who appeared to him twice, and had commanded him concerning this thing, that he should not go after other gods, but he did not observe what the Lord had commanded. God personally came to him twice. So the Lord said to Solomon, because you have done this, and you have not kept my covenant and my statutes which I have commanded you, I will surely tear the kingdom from you and will give it to your servant. You know, God's message in his covenant is not just this is what you do. It's also this is what you don't do. Amen. I mean, he says, remember the Sabbath, that's something to do. But then he turns around and says, don't commit adultery. Don't commit murder. Nevertheless, he's going to tear the kingdom from him. Nevertheless, I will not do it in your days for the sake of your father, David. Now, turn with me to 2 John. Now, brethren, you know, those who enter a race don't get the prize. Those who finish the race get the prize. Amen? You have to finish in order to get the prize. Nobody's going to say, hey, good, I'm glad you joined the race. No, it's you enter in. It's not enough to come out of Egypt. You've got to go across the Jordan. Most people that came out of Egypt did not go across the Jordan into the promise. See, that's not enough. Amen? And when we think about what happened with Solomon built the house of God and the glory, and there was so much rejoicing. You think of that. Just think of that magnificent building. I mean, one of the wonders of the world, probably the most awesome, most beautiful building ever. Matter of fact, when they rebuilt the temple under Ezra and Nehemiah, the old men that had seen the former temple wept because it was nothing compared to the temple that Solomon had built for the Lord. And it was magnificent. Think about all the work God anointed spiritually, all the workers, every single trade and craft that anybody had was spiritually charged by God in order to do the work for the temple. This was not just a temple built by the hands of men. It was built by the Spirit of God, according to the will of God, according to the pattern of the heavenly temple. And it was magnificent. And the people were humbled. And when Solomon prayed that majestic prayer of dedication, this is the same man that turned away. This is the same man that later didn't finish the race. And he prayed that magnificent prayer, and the glory of the Lord, the actual presence, the glory cloud, the golden cloud of the Lord came down, and the priests could not stand. It's so good. It's so powerful. I've experienced that myself. It's so powerful. And your knees, just your legs just go out from under you like rubber. We've seen the glory. I've seen it come through the roof. And so here's the glory of the Lord. And there's rejoicing. And everybody is so happy. This is God's house. And there it sits on the Temple Mount of Jerusalem for all to see. And people came from afar just to see. And that was the seat of God. God's presence dwelt in there. His eyes were there. They saw that we just read, that his eyes were there. So it was a wonderful moment in history for all mankind, particularly. This was when God says, okay, I am going to live in a house that you built for me because you want me there. But then Solomon, how did the devil get to Solomon? You know, I can't come at him directly. I can't really try to match wits with him necessarily. He is wise. He has the wisdom of God. He has a divine spirit. He has the Holy Spirit of God. He has the mind of Christ in him. How do I do it? I convince him that he is wise enough and smart enough and is strong enough that he can handle 1,000 wives. And he can have wives from other nations because he would never get in. Matter of fact, he's not worried about them, you know, turning him away. He will turn them to the Lord. He will teach them the Lord's way. Well, that's what people think to this very day. They'll go out and be unequally yoked. They'll say, yeah, but I'm going to bring them in. No, you're not. They're going to take you out. That's why God says, don't be unequally yoked. It's unequally yoked. And if you're outside of the will of God already, he's not working. Amen. So you have that wonderful thing taking place. And then Solomon turns away from God. And it's not long until the Lord raises up a Gentile king, Nebuchadnezzar, and he ordains him to go and defeat Judah and take away the Jews as slaves, some of them, like Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, many others, took the wise men out of the land to bring them to Babylon. And then they did burnt the temple of God. They took the valuables out, all the things that were for the service of God, the holy, all the articles that were holy. They took them out, and God did not strike them because he had ordained it. And then they burned the house of God. God allowed his own house to be burned. And people were wondering why. And it was simply for one reason. Because they forsook the Lord. That's why. Now notice here in 2 John chapter, there's only one chapter, verse 1. The elder to the chosen lady and her children, that's to the church and the brethren, whom I love in truth, and not only I, but all who know the truth, for the sake of the truth, which abides in us and will be in us forever. Grace, mercy, and peace will be with us from God the Father and from Jesus Christ, the Son of the Father, in truth and love. I was very glad to find some of your children walking in truth, just as we have received commandment to do so from the Father. Now I asked you, lady, that is the church, not as though I were writing to you a new commandment, but the one which we have had from the beginning, that we love one another. And this is love, that we walk according to his commandments. Now, John had to spell it out, and it has to be spelled out today, because people think love is all kinds of things. They think, well, the reason why I'm living with this person that I'm not married to is because I love them. The reason that I do this is because I love them. No, it's not. That's not the reason why. It's not love. It's lust. It could be a worldly love, which is just lust. It's just wicked desire. But real love, I mean, we're talking about real love, is sacrificial. It is obedient to God. And this is love, that we walk according to His commandments. And this is a commandment. Just you have heard from the beginning that you should walk in it. And then he says why. Now notice. For many deceivers have gone out into the world, those who do not acknowledge Jesus Christ as coming in the flesh. This is the deceiver and the antichrist. Watch yourselves, that you do not lose what we have accomplished, but that you may receive a full reward. You hear what he's saying? Watch yourself so that you do not lose anything. I want you to have a full reward. Anyone who goes too far and does not abide in the teaching of Christ does not have God. The one who abides in the teaching, he has both the Father and the Son. If anyone comes to you and does not bring this teaching, do not receive him into your house. And do not give him a greeting, for the one who gives him a greeting participates in his evil deeds. Now, you know, the teaching of Christ was what? Love one another. This commandment I leave to you, that you love one another. And this is love, that you keep my commandments. And they are not a burden to you. You see? So, commandment keeping is as much a part of love as any other action. Amen? Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 4. You know, brethren, 6 is a number of man. You know that. Man was created on the 6th day. All the beasts of the field were created on the 6th day. We find that the number 666 or 666 is both the number of a man and the beast. And symbolically, the beast, all beasts were created the same day man was created. But man was given dominion. You see, man was not to stay in 6. Man was to move into 7. Man was not to stay in the flesh. Man was to move into God. Man was to move into divine, into the divine. 6 secular days, 1 holy sanctified day that you move into it. And those who don't are falling short. They're falling one commandment short. Now, maybe they'll be ranked least in the kingdom and still be there. You know? If they're not sinning willfully, you see, maybe it's like Jehu, who, you know, did many, many things right, was considered righteous even though he didn't finish the job with dealing with the golden calves of Peniel and Bethel. And you find that that's normal. A lot of kings of Israel and Judah were considered righteous because they made reforms in the land, but they didn't always stop the worship in the high places. You know, people would still go up on mountains and still worship their pagan gods. I hope that we can be a church that goes beyond that. I hope that we can be a church to where we not only serve God, but we can get rid of the high places where the devil is worshipped, where the devil is honored, where paganism is honored, and that there's sacrifices made to the world, you know, and concessions to the world. I hope that we can be that way. And I hope as a pastor that God sees me as someone who, you know, certainly not like Solomon, but I don't want to be, I don't want to leave the golden calves either. Think about it. Don't you know people that, you know, to a degree, they love the Lord, but maybe not with their whole heart. Maybe they're a pastor, maybe they're another Christian. They love the Lord. There's no doubt about it. They love the Lord, but they're just not really willing to deal with the golden calves. You see what I'm saying? Jehu was a great man of God. He was a great man of God. I mean, he was a bigger than life. He was courageous. But when it came down to the sin of Jeroboam, he faltered there. God didn't curse him because of it personally, but the land suffered. The people suffered. You see what I mean? God wants to take each one of us to the highest place, to the fullest reward. He wants to take our church there. But it's up to us, brethren. It's up to us. You know, it's up to us. And, you know, God, the Bible says if we will seek Him, He'll let us find Him. If we'll seek Him with a whole heart, He will let us find Him. Amen. I mean, you know, some people say, well, I'm not in six. Islam, by the way, the sixth day of the week is their holy day, Friday. They're definitely in the flesh. But then some people will ignore it all and skip over. And some people say, well, there's not any difference. There's no difference. All days are the same. You know, God never said that. God never said all days are the same. God said 6 days are secular. 6 days are work days. The seventh day is holy, sanctified. And it is sanctified and set apart. Sanctified means set apart for holy use. It's the same way with the tithe. You don't take your tithe, you know, and go buy a popsicle with it. You see what I mean? Do you think God would bless you if you did? Of course He wouldn't. Because that's for the work of the service. That's for the church work. That's for the preaching of the gospel and for the expenses of the church. That's what it's for. God says, okay, I give you 90%, but that 10 is mine. I give you 6 days, but that seventh is mine. Don't touch it. Don't touch the tithe and don't touch it. Don't you touch it. It's holy. And if you touch it, I'll curse you. That's what He says. You will not enter my rest if you touch it. Now, there's provisions for people who don't know. There's no provisions for people who do it on purpose. Amen. Now, notice chapter 4 of Hebrews. Therefore, let us fear, if while a promise remains of entering His rest, any one of you may seem to have come short of it. For indeed, we have had good news preached to us, just as they, or Israel, had. But the word they heard did not profit them, because it was not united with faith in those who heard. For we who have believed enter that rest, just as He has said. You know why the children of Israel didn't cross the Jordan? Because they didn't believe they were able. You know why people don't do a lot of things? They say they're not able. Well, not able. I'm not able. Well, why are you living with someone that you're not married to? Why don't you, you know, separate? I'm not able. Why don't you put away those pagan holidays? I'm not able. What do you mean you're not able? Well, there's problems with family problems. Why don't you keep the holy days? Well, I'm not able. Why don't you keep the feast that I'm not able? What do you mean you're not able? Why don't you keep the Sabbath? Well, I'm not able. That's not true. The truth is, you're not willing. As I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest, although His works were finished from the foundation of the world. For He has said somewhere concerning the seventh day, and God rested on the seventh day from all of His works. And again, in this passage, they shall not enter my rest. You know, I want to tell you something you may or may not have realized. David kind of mentioned it, that we are high priests of the order of Melchizedek. But did you know that man, do you ever wonder why man sacrificed any at all? Why did Abel sacrifice? Why was, I mean, man was made the same day the beasts were, but man was given dominion. Only man was told to enter into the divine seventh day. The beasts weren't. The beasts just go out there and eat grass or whatever they're going to do, you know, eat fruit. Not man. Because man really was the intercessor. Man, the first Adam, was made to be the high priest. That's why the last Adam is the high priest, because the first one failed. Amen? That's why he entered into the seventh. That's why he entered into the seven, which is divine worship. As I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter my rest. Although his works were finished from the foundation of the world. Verse 4. For he said somewhere concerning the seventh day, and God rested on the seventh day from all of his works. And again, in this passage, they shall not enter my rest. In other words, they're not following his example. Therefore, since it remains for some to enter it, and those who formerly had good news preached to them failed to enter because of why? Disobedience. Simple. And when the children of Israel were in the wilderness, they found somebody gathering sticks on the Sabbath. They said, well, what is this man doing? We don't even know what to do yet. God hadn't even told us what to do. He had told us to keep the Sabbath day, but he hadn't told us what to do if someone didn't. So they brought him. He was just gathering some sticks. He needed some sticks. He should have gathered them on Friday, but he didn't. He ran out. So he went and he gathered them on the Sabbath day, and they found him. They said, they brought him to Moses and said, we don't know what to do. And Moses said, I don't know what to do either. We'll have to ask the Lord. You know what the Lord said? He shall surely die. Stone him to death for doing such thing. Why? Gathering sticks? I mean, what's the big deal? It was a big deal to God. He didn't enter in, see? He didn't enter into the rest. Therefore, since it remains for some to... But you know why? Because that was symbolic of the rest. See? Just like the birthright was... Esau wouldn't enter into the natural birthright. God knew he wouldn't enter into the spiritual birthright. If this man wouldn't enter into the Sabbath, God knew he wouldn't enter into the eternal rest. It's symbolic. That's why the Bible says that the Sabbath is a sign between me and my people. Therefore, since it remains for some to enter, and those who formerly had good news preached to them failed to enter because of why? Disobedience. He again fixes a certain day, today, saying through David, after so long a time, just as has been said before, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. For if Joshua had given them rest, he would not have spoken of another day after that. So he's saying the rest wasn't just across the Jordan. There's a greater rest. So notice verse 9. So there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. And the Greek word there is sabbatismos. Now, some people, some translations will just put rest there. And you know, rest is mentioned more than one time. They shall not enter my rest. The Greek word there is katapusis. But the Greek word for rest in verse 9 is sabbatismos. And that means one thing only, keeping the Sabbath holy. So he says, and this is what he's saying in the New Testament, even now there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. He's saying just as there's a weekly Sabbath, there's an eternal Sabbath. That's what he's saying. For the one who has entered his rest has himself also rested from his works, as God did from his. In other words, he said the person who enters the Sabbath is resting from his works, just like God did. As God did from his, therefore, let us be diligent to enter that rest so that no one will fall through following the same example of disobedience. For the word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, and piercing as far as the division of soul and spirit, of both joints and marrow, able to judge the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. Chapter 6, verse 4. And It says here, for in the case of those who have once been enlightened and have tasted the heavenly gift and have been made partakers of the Holy Spirit. In other words, they've tasted of Jesus. They've eaten the manna from heaven and they have the Holy Spirit. And they understand the Word of God and the powers of the age to come. And then they have fallen away. It is impossible to renew them again to repentance. That's what happened to Esau. Since they again crucified to themselves the Son of God and put him to open shame. For the ground drinks the rain, which often falls on it and brings forth vegetation useful to those. See, God planted us here. And he planted the Word in us. And he planted his Word in us for it to produce fruits. The fruits of obedience. He planted us in this world in order to be lights to the world. The world can look at us and say, yeah, see, he's doing what God says to do. And if they want to do what's right, they can follow our example. Amen. So he says, the ground drinks rain, which often falls on it to bring vegetation. Now, when you look at vegetation, you see good fruit and you see weeds. Amen. Now, the rain doesn't just fall on the good plants. It also falls on weeds. See? But the weeds produce what? Nothing but trouble. But the good plants produce something that is useful. So he says, for the ground that drinks the rain, which often falls on it and brings forth vegetation useful to those for whose sake it is even tilled. See, God is working the garden. He wants fruit. It receives a blessing from God, but if it yields thorns and thistles, it is worthless and close to being cursed, and it ends up being burned in the fire. Now, that's just symbolic of hell. Our final scripture over in chapter 10. We need to understand both the grace and the love of God, the forgiveness of God, but the severity of God. God is a righteous judge. Amen. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 26. We'll read 26 through 31. And then after this, Brian will come up and close us in prayer. For if we go on sinning willfully after receiving the knowledge of the truth. In other words, you know, we make a decision. That doesn't mean stumbling from time to time. That means we make a decision. You know what? I'm choosing the world, or I'm choosing a lie, or I'm choosing to disobey God. If we go on sinning willfully, that means we're following our own will. We've received the knowledge of the truth, but we're not going to follow that. Oh, we may throw God a bone once in a while. I mean, we might say, here. I mean, Solomon did that. Solomon still sacrificed to the Lord, but it doesn't do any good. You know, the Apostle Paul said in Corinthians, you cannot sit at the table of God's table and the table of demons. And those things that the pagans did were worshiping demons. So if we go on sinning willfully after receiving the knowledge of the truth, see, where there's truth and where there's understanding of truth, knowledge of truth, then there is accountability. There no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a terrifying expectation of judgment and the fury of a fire which will consume the adversaries. Anyone who has set aside the law of Moses dies without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. He said, this is how it was in the Old Covenant. In the covenant of the book of the law given at Sinai. It says, anyone who sets aside the law of Moses dies without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. And that's ratified by the blood of animals. But he says, how much severe punishment do you think he will receive who has trampled underfoot the Son of God and is regarded as unclean the blood of the covenant. This is a new covenant. By which he was sanctified and has insulted the spirit of grace. For we know him who said, vengeance is mine, I will repay. And again, the Lord will judge his people. It is a terrifying thing to fall into the hands of the living God. So let's don't fall short. Either of the grace of God are of the reward that he has for us. Amen. Y'all rise.